Yeah. I remember the first rhyme I wrote. I don't remember everything I wrote, but I was at my great aunt Edna's house. And it was so much of LL. It was so much of a bad bite, you know, but it was, but I said, I'm sneaking up behind you, and before you can blink, I'll have 100 million rhymes, and like a ship, you will sink. You know, when I retire, I'll be worshipped like an old battleship.
Not long ago, I went to see the music producer Rick Rubin. He lives in Malibu. We'd never met before, but we'd been talking for a couple months about doing a project together called Broken Record, which would be a place for us and for others to tell stories about music, all kinds. Where songs come from, how they're made, why they work. Rick lives in this strange minimalist house overlooking the ocean, and he has a room which is all white, white walls, white floor, with nothing in it except a white couch and this elaborate sound system. We'd only been talking half an hour, and he said, "I want to play you a song." It was something he'd produced. It wasn't finished yet, but he played me the most recent version. He didn't say anything else. I listened, and it floored me.
Well, this is the thing. When you start out in your career, you have a blank canvas. So you can paint anywhere that you want because the shit ain't been painted on yet. And then your second album comes out and you paint a little more and you paint a little more. By the time you get to your seventh and eighth album, you've already painted all over. There's nowhere else to paint.
Understood.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, where do you go? And people are always expecting something different from you. I want him to talk about this. I want him to talk about that. I want him to just spit. I don't like when he just spits. He does too much rappity-rappity shit. I don't like when he self-loathes. He does that shit too much. I don't like when he, you know, puts all them syllables together, but they don't mean anything. You start running out of, there's less places to go that you haven't already been. So that's kind of how I feel like all the time.
The song is called Walk on Water. It was recorded at Shangri-La, which is just up the road from Rubin's house. Bob Dylan used to record there. In fact, one of Dylan's old tour buses has been converted into a studio. It's high up in a hill. Everything's white, of course, and wide open. The song is about that line, written from long ago. When I retire, I'll be worshipped like an old battleship. And how it didn't come true.
My experience with him is everything is written during the process. I may play him a bunch of different ideas to see if there's one that sheds light on a direction to start from.
Do you remember any of the music you played, the songs you guys were listening to when you were trying to get inspiration for this album?
I remember I played him a Frank Zappa song that I thought had some...
Oh, really? Which one?
It's a really early one. I can't remember, but it was a protest song, and I thought the energy of this might be right for him.
The song's chorus is this beautiful hook. I walk on water, but I ain't no Jesus. I walk on water, but only when it freezes. It was written by Skylar Grey.
I didn't even play it for him, like, listen to this, this is great. It was more like, I happened to be listening to it, and he came into the control room, and he said, "Oh, what's that?" And I said, "Oh, it's a hook Skylar wrote." And he just sat there, and he's listening to it, and he's like,
They'd just been talking about the rise of mumble rap. And there was something about that line, "I walk on water, but only when it freezes," that touched a nerve.
So for him, it's a little bit of a culture shock because there's a new wave of hip hop that's not really what he's about. So he was just talking to me about how that felt.
What did he say?
I could see he was frustrated by it.
He felt frustrated. Why? Because he's Eminem. His whole world is in his lyrics.
He's fanatical to a point that I don't think I've ever seen before in anyone, just to his attention to detail. He has a perfect memory of everything about the music, and he gets inside of it and writes to whatever's good or bad about it. He wants the rhythm of the words to bounce off of the beat in a very particular way.
My favorite moment in Rick's conversation with Eminem is when Rick starts talking about how it's different working with Eminem than other artists. With others, he'll fiddle with the music after he gets the vocals to make them work better together. But he can't do that with Eminem because, and this is the phrase he uses, Eminem writes to the beat as the beat is. And just that stray observation makes Eminem light up. And he launches into this big digression.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so funny. You know, I've always, you know, I've been a student of hip hop and I've always studied rap. And one of the things I learned from Tupac was whenever he was like, I don't know how he just always knew the right words to say on the right chords. And it was almost like if he wanted to make this statement, I remember when he said, my broken down TV show cartoons in my living room. Hey, on Unconditional Love, a song he had. I was like, oh my God, he could have said that on the bar before it and it wouldn't have meant as much. But he said it right here where the chord got sad. And the, you know, like I studied that so much and was like, oh my God, he was so genius at like doing that. It was like he never said the wrong thing on the wrong chord. Listen to Dear Mama. Every single thing, every single thought, every single word, every bar was like so in place where it should be, just because of he was so smart about picking his beats. And just, you know, he, like Tupac always said, feel me, and you have to feel him and not just hear him.
And then Rick asks a follow-up, and Eminem goes off again on this passionate riff about all the music he grew up with.
When I first got introduced to hip-hop, I started with Ice-T, and N.W.A. came out, and Audio 2, and Alliance, and Lovin' Kool G Rap, and Big Daddy Kane, and Master Ace, and the whole Juice Crew, Beastie Boys, God, Third Bass, everything that was good hip-hop, you know. It just, you know, God, Tretch, Naughty by Nature, the whole Flavor Unit, Lakim Shabazz. There's so many that I learned from, you know, and just study, and Biggie, and Big L, and Poor Righteous Teachers, YZ, Rakim, KRS-One, Wu-Tang, Leaders of the New School, Jay-Z, Nas, AZ.
What were you like before hip-hop?
Public Enemy. I didn't say Public Enemy. I meant to say
Public. What were you like before hip-hop? Because I have a picture of you in my mind as Eminem the Rapper for as long as I've known you.
Oh, man, I was such a nerdy kid.
Who was Marshall?
Marshall didn't really know who he was.
Marshall didn't really know who he was. That's the heart of it, I think. Here you have an artist whose identity is in his craft. And now, suddenly, in some unconscious way, maybe he feels like the ground is slipping ever so slightly out from under his feet. That anxiety is the price of obsession. It's what happens when you care so much, when you've invested so much, and then you wake up one morning and you wonder if anyone cares.
It's a very mortal song. It's, I mean, like, you know, it's mortality. It's, you know, not being Superman. And what if I can't come up with the best shit I've ever wrote every single time, you know?
Rick went to see Jay-Z. Beyonce was out of town and played him the song. He liked it, and she liked it, and he got her to sing the chorus.
The reason I wanted to play it for him was because I'm sure these same feelings cross his mind. I'm sure these same feelings cross any very successful artist's mind.
I think these feelings cross the mind of everyone who's ever cared deeply about something. Walk on water.
I walk on water, but I ain't no Jesus. I walk on water, but only when it freezes.
Why? Are expectations so high? Is it the bar I set? My arms I stretch, but I can't reach? A far cry from it, or it's in my grasp, but as soon as I grab, squeeze, I lose my grip like the flying trapeze. Into the dark I plummet. Now the sky's blackening. I know the mark's high, but flies rip apart my stomach. Knowing that no matter what bars I come with, you're gonna harp griping. That's a hard fight getting to swallow. So I scrap these as pressure increases like khakis. I feel the ice cracking because
I walk on water. But I know Jesus. I walk on water. But only when it freezes.
It's the curse of the standard that the first of the Mathers disc set. Always in search of the verse that I haven't spit yet. Will this step just be another misstep to tarnish whatever the legacy, love, or respect I've garnered? The rhyme has to be perfect, the delivery flawless. And it always feels like I'm hitting the mark till I go sit in the car, listen and pick it apart. Like this shit is garbage. God's given me all this, still I feel no different regardless. Kids look to me as a god, this is retarded. If only they knew, it's a facade and it's exhaustive. And I try not to listen to nonsense, but if you bitches are trying to strip me of my confidence, mission accomplished. I'm not Godson, Nas, Rakim, Pac, Big James, Todd Smith, and I'm not Prince.
I walk on water, but I ain't no Jesus. I walk on water, but only when it freezes.
I'm a Rubik's, a beautiful mess. At times juvenile, yes. I goof and I jest. A flawed human, I guess. But I'm doing my best to not ruin your expectations and meet them. But first, the speed em verse. Now Big Sean, he's going too fast. Is he gonna shout or curse out his mom? There was a time I had the world by the balls eating out my palm. Every album song I was spazzing the fuck out on. And now I'm getting clowned and frowned on. But the only one who's looking down on me that matters now's Deshaun. Am I lucky to be around this long? Begs the question though, especially after the methadone is yesterday fades and the Dresden home is burnt to the ground and all that's left of my house is lawn. The crowds are gone and it's time to wash out the blonde. Sales decline, the curtains drawn, they're closing the set. I'm still poking my head from out behind. And everyone who has doubt remind, now take your best rhyme, outdo it, now do it 1,000 times. Now let them tell you the world no longer cares or gives a fuck about your rhymes. And as I grow out of sight, out of mind, I might go out of mind. Cause how do I ever let this mic go without a fight when I made a fucking tightrope out of twine? But when I do fall from these heights, though, I'll be fine. I won't pout or cry or spiral down or whine. But I'll decide if it's my final bow this time around. Cause
I'll walk on.
I'm just a man, but as long as I got a mic, I'm godlike. So me and you are not alike, bitch. I wrote Stan.
This is Rick Rubin.
This is Malcolm Gladwell.
You're listening to Broken Record.
Awesome. Oh, shit. I forgot Run DMC. Why did I forget Run DMC? There's too much. I can't. Anybody I forget, I always, like, if I'm in an interview or something, I'll start thinking about it afterwards and be like, ah, fuck. Why didn't I say, you know, I don't know. I just wanted to say that. Run DMC, amazing. Rick Rubin, amazing. DJ Double R. Thank you, man.